folks, here we are for another worship service this week online, and how good it is that we can share in this service together. Martin and I have had some little hiccups in the last week, and we're trying to get Google onto it. Our Google link, well, we had too many downloads. We didn't even know that that was a thing, but it was. So we apologise if you tried to see our service last week and you got mucked around. I'm really sorry. We will be putting out a couple of different links this week. There'll be a Google link. There'll be probably a YouTube link. We did lose one of the songs when it goes onto YouTube. And let me just explain to you quickly. We download our songs off YouTube. We have our Christian copyright licensing and our broadcast licensing, and we've got all that in place. But see, even though we download a song off YouTube, sometimes we put it back onto our service and YouTube says, no, you can't play that. We don't think that you've got the broadcast rights for it. It's kind of really crazy. But in saying that, how good it's been this week, many of you would know I had my 50th birthday, and look, it's been funny. Every church I've been in, there's been other people who've had August the 12th as their birthday too. So shout out to Darren down at Albion Park, happy birthday to you, and Sarah Cosgrove over in Perth, happy birthday to you. And in this church we've got Dave Clark and, well, Liam as well, happy birthday to you guys. It's been great to share that day with you. And on the 13th this week, Craig Finlay, 60. Well, that makes me feel young, doesn't it? Anyway, we were in the same decade for a whole 24 hours. But folks, as we join together in worship today, we're heading through Matthew's Gospel, and what a great time it is. And we look at some of the different traditions and things that are going on in the church. And I'm not against tradition, but I don't want tradition to drive the church. I need the scriptures. I need the Holy Spirit to be driving the church, not traditions. And sometimes we've been doing things in the church for so long that we just don't think we can change it. And if we do, well, it's not going to be good. You know, I've told my congregations a lot of different times, there's seven deadly words that'll kill a church. We've always done it this way. Well, sometimes we need to be doing things in a new way. So as you can see, we're doing these services online as well as doing them in the church. Well, we won't know until Saturday afternoon whether we're doing them in the church or not. But I've got to say that when we're doing it this way, we haven't always done church this way, but how good it is that we can share in this worship service with you. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for the newness of life that today brings. We thank you for all the joy that it brings us to be able to share and worship in this new setting, in this new way, and that the traditions of the church aren't washed away because we're doing it in this setting. In fact, they're actually enhanced, and they speak richly into what we're doing in connecting with you, Father God, in connecting with brothers and sisters in different ways and shapes. And we just ask that you'd put a peace in our heart. For those of us who are a bit troubled at this time, you'd put a peace into our heart as we head into these days ahead. In Christ's name, amen.
Our good Father, we get up each morning and every day is so much the same. Nothing much seems to happen. Nothing much changes. Sometimes we are bored and sometimes we complain about the daily grind. Sometimes we are frightened about the future. But too often, when disaster comes, we're not prepared. Forgive us for not being aware of how your love meets us and how your Spirit calls us to open our eyes and ears to see and hear new wonders every day. Make us aware of what a great adventure life always is with you and what resources there are available to ride life's storms and come through trouble and pain still praising you. Give us power of utterance to proclaim the great things that you are always doing through the power of the Spirit and the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we praise you, God, for the coming in Jesus, right to the heart of human darkness, right to the heart of human difficulty and the struggles of every day, where the brutal, hurting realities of life and death, wearying disappointment and frustration, make our hard lives a reality. But Christ comes into all those places just for us. We praise you that out of the soil of suffering and death, your Spirit brought hope, joy, and the promise of life that cannot be broken or subdued. Through the darkness, there is light. Through death comes resurrection. And we praise you for your Spirit with us now, bringing us with Christ through every day, through life and death, to where he reigns eternally with you and perfect praise rings out forever. Gracious God, we thank you for Jesus' death and resurrection on the cross, for the newness of life that today brings, and for those precious words you utter into our lives this morning and every other morning, your sins are forgiven. And we say, thanks be to God. Amen.
A show dressed in righteous deeds to hide all the stains below. We have judged your sons and daughters for the sin that is our own. May we now forgive each other and lay down a stone. Forgive us for our love of the things we wish to own. We forsake the feast above for all the crumbs below. Though you made us sons and daughters, we do not the world disown. May we find our greatest treasure is in you. Forget we're free at last. We avoid as sons and daughters for the fear we don't belong. Give us eyes to see each other through your only Son.
Well, folks, here we are in the church, and this week we're talking about traditions. And there are many different traditions. I remember when I was round about 10 or 11 years of age, having an argument with one of my friends, Roscoe, about who got to carry the brass chicken into church. Now, you might go, what's a brass chicken? Well, in the church we're in the choir, and they used to have this big long pole, and on top of it was this big brass eagle. It was as heavy as all get up, but that was tradition. We had to carry that into the church. Well, here are some of the congregation and other people telling you some of the traditions that they're glad, well, aren't really there anymore.
One of the things the church doesn't do these days is have signed communion cards, which is a way of checking that people are still coming to church and they could take communion.
the question, what is one thing that you think it's great the church no longer does? And my answer is the use of Old English.
What traditions make the church irrelevant? I think it's the way they put robes on when they start their services, which I think is ridiculous.
What traditions make the church irrelevant? I have often thought about the use of women and men in delivering the word of the Lord. And I think many times I've actually enjoyed delivery by women as opposed to men. I've also seen several churches that have been rescued by the preaching of women. And so therefore I think that some denominations, not including women, are actually missing out on a lot.
I think of things that are good and bad. Things that are bad, I still feel are an irrelevant, are the wearing of robes and such things and going through a lot of rigmarole for the ministry. And the things that are good are that now we have the option of, in communion, of either a cup or individual cups, which wasn't there when I was growing up.
What one thing you think is great that the church no longer does? To me personally, you can come to church in any attire that you feel comfortable in and still feel accepted as part of the church family. Thank you.
You're looking at me? In my finery? I mean, who doesn't wear this to worship today, huh? Like, I must pull this out. I mow the lawn in it, it's so good. I mean, that's how much I love these robes. What, it's not modern enough for you? Maybe a little cheeky off-the-shoulder number, or maybe a plunging neckline. I mean, we can do amazing things with our frocks, can't we? Anyway, off to worship. Thou hast to doest a service for Martine.
May the peace of the Lord be with you all. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
Oh. Hi there. May the peace of the Lord be with you all. Unlike what this broken stormwater pipe's giving me right now. Come and have a look. Okay, back to work now.
Lord, we pray for this modern world in which faith comes hard, where people find it difficult to raise their eyes above the material things which are so necessary to life. We pray for those who find it hard to believe because they have too many things, and for those who find it hard because they haven't enough. We pray for those who have more to eat than they need, and those who are dying from lack of food. We pray for parents who, because of their poverty and a lack of concern on the part of others, must watch their children die. We pray for those who suffer from disease, from confusion and guilt, from depression and fear. We pray for those who face each day with dread because their lives are so dominated by the power of others. We pray for those who are so lonely that life is robbed of all loveliness and hope. Lord, we pray because our love for you is a love for one whose compassion embraces all human suffering. Heavenly Father, we continue to pray for the COVID situation, for those who have it, and for those in the health profession exposed to possible infection. Please keep them safe and well. Behind the constancy of the COVID situation, there are many others who need our prayers. COVID dominates our thoughts and lives. 8 months after the White Island disaster, there are burns victims still being treated in hospital. We pray for their healing, mentally and physically, and for their families who visit. We pray for all those carers who have to go to and from hospitals, a wearing experience. Grant them perseverance and strength and your comfort. We pray for those living with cancer. Be with these people as they undergo treatment, chemotherapy and radiotherapy. Treatment can cause discomfort. We pray for your healing and strength to be given to them. We pray for all those who grieve, remembering Bob and his family on the loss of his mum and the difficulties posed by border restrictions. We pray for your comfort and love. We pray for the broader church, for Presbytery, Synod, and for fellow Christians in our neighbourhood, nation, and abroad. God, you are much needed in our world. We thank you for the witness and mission of your people locally and abroad. We pray for those who teach scripture, for Mon and her family, for the work of Frontier Services and for Hadzia. Help us to have confidence to tell others of the role that you have in our lives. We pray for our congregation members, especially those unable to attend church face to face. We pray that through our online service, they'll be able to enjoy worshipping you, and may they know our prayers are for them. Keep them safe and may they feel supported by other people in the congregation. May they find encouragement in their faith journey. We pray your Holy Spirit will be with them in their lives. We pray for the activities of our church, for our craft group and its members, for the neighbourhood garden, for pastoral partners, for our music teams. We pray you will grant wisdom and guidance to Nick and our church council. And may your will be done. These things we bring before you in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. Your majesty, you are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your name. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, to the Lord of heaven and earth, hallelujah. We
reveal your heart to me. Father, hold me, hold me. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. You are holy.
Good morning, Church. Today's reading is taken from Matthew chapter 15, verses 1 to 20. Clean and unclean. Then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem and asked, "Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat." Jesus replied, "And why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition? For God said, 'Honour your father and mother,' and anyone who curses his father and mother must be put to death. But you say that if a man says to his father or mother, 'Whatever help you might otherwise have received from me is a gift devoted to God,' he is not to honour his father with it. Thus you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. You hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. 'These people honour me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men.'" Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen and understand. What goes into a man's mouth does not make him unclean, but what comes out of his mouth, that is what makes him unclean." Then the disciples came to him and asked, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this?" He replied, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them, they are blind guides. If a blind man leads a blind man, both will fall into a pit." Peter said, "Explain the parable to us." "Are you still so dull?" Jesus asked them. "Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart, and these make a man unclean. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what make a man unclean, but eating with unwashed hands does not make him unclean." This is the word of the Lord.
The realms of glory.
Good morning, church. How good it is to be looking at this passage today. As we see Matthew's perspective of this story of Jesus coming and engaging the Pharisees yet again. Jesus often takes on the Pharisees in Matthew's gospel. And when he does so, he uses the scriptures in which to back himself up to actually defend his arguments. And so this is quite a common way of rabbis back then arguing, was they would use the scriptures to justify and put forward their argument or their point of view. And so Jesus does exactly this. But a lot of the time when Jesus does it, he actually twists and turns them up upside down or almost leads them down a garden path and leaves them standing in their own compost heap. And they get really, really annoyed at it each time.
Jesus often challenges the difference between being religious and that of being a friend of God or being a follower of God. And so for us as Christians, we would say he challenges us to what it is to be religious in the church today versus that of being Christ followers. And I want to say that I'm a Christ follower, and I want you to be a Christ follower, not just a religious or a pragmatic person who knows how to do things. Traditions can be a good thing. So don't get me wrong, I'm going to challenge some of the traditions today in the church, and they can be very good. But also, when they become a religious act or a movable, they shackle and they cause irrelevancy in how the gospel and how the church is perceived by the greater community. I was speaking to a rabbi a number of years back, and when I was speaking to him about different things that happened in the scriptures, because I just wanted to say, well, how does this whole thing of rabbis and stories all go? And so he was talking about there's symbolism in different things. So when we get to something like the story today, there's symbolism and tradition in the washing of hands. Not that they were just COVID safe, but that's always good to be, you know, washing our hands nice and COVID safe. Everyone keep doing that. Yep, keep doing it. But it also shows that the tradition of washing your hands when you finish work or finish a task and starting a new one is to say that we are washing our hands, so we're stopping the old task and we're taking on the new task. And often it was to stop doing our task and then to share a meal. So yes, there is an aspect of cleanliness about it, but it's to actually say that what I was doing in my work in the fields or what I was doing in my work in the marketplace has ceased. And now I am here to spend time of community sharing with my hands in this meal as we head and it's all is clean and fresh and we start anew each time. So we finish off one task before getting into the next. Sometimes traditions have been a real challenge, and we've seen not only in our own early church history and our latter church history how traditions sometimes have really negatively impacted upon how churches continue to move forward. But don't think that this is unique, because if we actually go back to Galatians, in Galatians 2, Paul writes this: when Peter came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. Well, Paul had made a fairly strong opinion here. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in this hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. You see, the tradition of separating themselves out as those who came from a Jewish tradition and those who came from a Gentile tradition was actually starting to impact the early church. And Paul directly goes in there, and Paul, being a man who's been rabbinically trained and knows all of the different traditions down pat, but also sees himself as the evangelist to the Gentiles, not to the Jews, he comes into this situation and he takes these guys on and he says, "What are you doing? Why are you segregating yourselves? Why are you separating differences here and causing shifts and schisms in the faith? Because for what benefit? All are one in Christ." Well, I often think that sometimes our traditions in the church, well, they cause tensions. And the tension that's caused when tradition becomes a dominant methodology for relevancy is just huge. Because when we all of a sudden start saying, well, unless you do this, then you're not actually doing church or worship properly. Let me give you a small example. And I know that some of you online are going to sit there and say, "Oh, Nick, please, no, don't head down this path." Candles. There's a tension because sometimes people don't feel that their service has been started correctly if they haven't had a candle lit to start the service. Well, a candle lighting wasn't actually any part of Jesus' theology that we've read about. There's nothing that really gives us an image that even in the earliest of church that a candle was lit and a certain little passage was said to start a service. Yet in some places, we put so much dominance on the lighting of the candle and its passage to start the service and the blowing out or snuffing of the candle and the sending of us into the world that it actually becomes a dominant methodology. But when people come in from outside of the church and walk in and they go, how is this relevant today? They don't see the relevance because it's a tradition that, although it's steeped in richness and beauty of what happened in the older church through the medieval ages, it really doesn't purvey the same story into today's culture. And the other problem we then have, though, is sometimes we throw out all of our traditions. And so when we do that, we end up throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Very, very unhelpful, because there are some traditions and there are some things that the church has done in the past that we need to have, that it keeps us informed into the future as little warning points, warnings of what can go wrong if we allow certain things not to take place. But there are also the seven words, the seven most deadly words, and the seven famous last words of any church before it dies. We have always done it this way. We have always done it this way. They are the seven famous deadly words of a church. You know, if we were still doing evangelistic outreach the same way Billy Graham was in the 50s of last century, I don't think we'd have any relevancy into today's society. In fact, if we didn't use the internet and we didn't have the internet and we didn't, you know, it's almost like Bible reading. Someone was challenging me about Bible reading just recently and said, well, everyone should have a Bible in their home. And I said, well, everyone does have a Bible. No, they should have it in their hands. And I said, well, everyone has access to a Bible in their hands right here, right now, more so now than ever before. And they said, no, that's not true. And I said, actually, anyone who has a smartphone has a Bible in their hands. And in fact, better than that, because where we like to sometimes read the scriptures, you know, actually read it out, and that's what we do in church, more so now, the younger folk coming through and some of the people who haven't been connected to church, when they want the scriptures, they actually want to have a video or they want an MP3 of it. They want something that engages them visually as it goes through. And I get it. I actually understand what it's all about. We're using the kind of cutting edge technology that we have today in which to present the scriptures and the gospel. Why not? So if we keep saying, but we've always done it that way, I actually think that you'll probably see your church die. Now, for those of you who aren't part of my church, because you've probably seen that we've changed a few things over the years, but for those of you who aren't, this is the season we are in with COVID at this time is one of the most unique seasons where we've shut churches and shut down certain things in churches. And there's been some of our ministries and missions or missional things that we've held on to desperately, even though they've been on their last gasp. Well, guess what? Now's the perfect time to actually allow that ministry to come to a conclusion, to hold a little celebratory thing and say, thank you, we're now waiting for the new season and we'll be ready for that. And it's also a great season at the moment with things a little bit out of kilter from what normally is to start planning our new things. Traditions, however, can become religious and lose its spiritual aspect. Modern traditions of song choices in particular give us an example of that. So you might actually sit there and have a tradition, a song that you think, oh, it really ministers to my heart. And all of a sudden it becomes a tradition. You know, you might be a church that sings a blessing at the end of each service. And you might sing the Edelweiss blessing every second week. One of my friend's churches does that and they love to sing it. But when people turn up there and they're new, they actually go, although that is a beautiful song, and although it's rich and steeped in tradition for that church, that's really not us. And they say, isn't that just kind of like a Mr. Whippy song gone wrong? I am joking a little bit when I say it, but there are challenges with some of our traditions. Some of our other things come like the baptism, the sacrament of baptism. Now, we always say there's only two sacraments. As a Protestant church, we have two sacraments, that of communion and that of baptism. Well, the baptism is where it starts, where we have the washing away of the impurity of life. And the symbolism of a child being washed or an adult being washed in a full immersion in particular, and it is wonderful. It's starting anew. And then there's the public profession of God. And in fact, you can't have communion without baptism. You can't actually have voting or membership rights without baptism. So it's a really important thing. But is all of a sudden baptism become a tradition or is it still a sacrament? And are we pushing it a little bit further? See, it's interesting, isn't it? Part of the baptism service when you're an adult is confirmation. And in fact, you can't become a voting member of a church without confirmation either. So you might be baptized when you're 1 year of age, but when you're 17, you need to actually get confirmed before you are a fully voting member of the church. Sounds crazy, but this is the type of thing that sometimes can really confuse people. For those of you who are part of the church kind of hierarchy, yeah, that's probably my heresy. You've got me. Anyway, we'll move on and have a talk about that. But as we head back into this passage, Jesus does, he challenges one of the most important things. He actually takes from the leaders of the day, the Pharisees, he talks about what is a subtext that's been taken out of context and given a pretext. So what he does is he takes this word koban. And koban is, they were paying money to the temple, so you give a special offering to the temple, a special gift to the temple, but in doing so, it allows them to then go and ignore the command to honour their mother and father in their latter years and look after them. So it's almost like they're sitting, living in community and saying, well, here I am living in my community and I'm just going to give a special offering to the temple, and then I don't need to worry about my aged parents. God will look after them because I've given koban, and that's where I give my money to. Whereas actually the scriptures would say, in the Old Testament in particular, that if you have money and your parents do not have the money, you should be by honour them, you would honour them by giving them money and supporting them. And it never gives you any right in the Old Testament to walk away from anyone in your family who is in need, let alone your community. So here it is that Jesus takes the Old Testament and takes the traditions where they were saying, well, I've paid my money to the temple. It would be like people walking into my church today and saying, Nick, I'm just going to put a lazy hundred in the offering. My parents are in an old people's home, but I'm never going to go and visit them again because, hey, I've given $100 to you and that should make me right with God, so who cares about them? If that was happening, I'd probably challenge that person and say, you know what, that's not how God calls you to respond to your parents. God is not a consumeristic God. You don't buy God. You don't buy his forgiveness. You don't buy anything. He paid the price for us. He paid the price for us. And that is a really exciting thing. So when you're looking at this thing of, oh, well, if I give enough to the church, then God, no, please just stop. Jesus then goes on and because he's engaging them, and he starts to head down some more things, and he says, well, you know, you're not defiled by what you eat. You're defiled by what you say and do. You're defiled by what you say and what you do. You're not defiled by what you eat. And they were saying, but if you eat and if you're not eating the right foods, if you're not eating with clean hands, then you're not going to be clean. Jesus is saying, no, hold on. You're actually defiled by what you say and do, because it's what's on the inside of us. It's who's on the inside of us that really matters. See, it's interesting. If you go back through some of the Old Testament laws, you were impure if you touched a dead person, which is why when you think about the story of the Good Samaritan, the priest and that didn't touch the man because he could have been dead. And if he had been dead, they couldn't actually have gone and worshipped in the temple that day. And so obviously that poor person on the road was less important than making sure that they got their temple time in. But also, if you're a woman or you're a man, you've gone to battle, then you're unclean as well. If you're a woman who's in your menstruation time, you're unclean. And that's why the woman who had bled for all those years, who reached out and touched Jesus' cloak to be made healed again, it was so important because she hadn't been allowed in the temple courts to worship God in the courts for many, 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 many years. If you had dirty hands, yeah, you're unclean. If you didn't eat kosher food, so the right food things, you're unclean. If you'd given birth to a male child, you are unclean for 7 days. If it was to a female child, it was 42 days. Don't know why. That's a strange one. Anyway, if you went into the wrong people's houses, so Jesus gets challenged because he hangs out with the prostitutes and the tax collectors. Wrong people, shouldn't be there, Jesus. You should be unclean. Or if you go to foreigners' houses and engage with foreigners, again, unclean. But Jesus breaks down all these barriers. He's saying, actually, no, that's not right. No, the compassion of God. What was the call in the Old Testament? The call was to go to the north and south and east and west and take the message of God to all nations. And the people of Israel didn't do it. Well, you can do religion, but it's not a spectator sport. We should desire communion and fellowship and not just feel obligated to do it. You know, going to church, I was so excited when we were allowed to come back into church. I really miss being in fellowship and being in communion with brothers and sisters. And, you know, when we pray, it's so important that we just pray from our heart and not just read stuff out of a book or read stuff, words up on a screen and go through the motions. I know that for some churches, they find it helpful to use the call and response prayers and other things. But if all you do is you do that every week and you never in your own time find that precious time to just talk to God as your friend, that I'm going to encourage you, go talk to God. He is your friend. He is beautifully waiting with ears open and arms open to just have that great conversation with you. There's no formula of religious acts that guarantee salvation. So if you're going through just religious acts and thinking that that's all you need, it's wrong, because there's none of that will guarantee you salvation. Jesus actually says their worship is a farce. You know, life is worship, not just the 1 hour a week in church or however long it is. Life is worship. And this is not an Old Testament imperative. You see, life is equals just being in worship. We're called to follow the way of Christ Jesus. Worship is meaningful. It has to be meaningful. And you know what? We could always do worship better. There are ways and means of doing worship better. And I always encourage people when they come to church, whether they're new or they're coming back or whatever it is, how do you find worship? Tell me what's working for you. Tell me what's not. I like to ask my elders. I like to ask my church council, how could we be doing this better and remaining relevant? But have some of our traditions stayed in the church and actually jaded our view or blinded us from how things could be doing better? And if so, what do we change? Well, here's the thing. If there's something you'd like to change in my church, as long as you come here, I'd encourage you, send me an email about what you think might need to be changed. And what about the format? Are you happy with the format? What about life beyond the service? What could we be doing better outside the front doors of the church? And how do we stay relevant to a society without being driven by society? See, we've got to be relevant to society and we've got to be living and breathing the society that surrounds us. But it doesn't tell us how to be Christians. The scriptures informs us of how to be Christians. And in fact, we live sometimes a countercultural life because we live this life under Jesus and under God as our king. We don't live it under the world as our king or as under sin being our king. Purity doesn't come from the church. Now, I'm going to say that again. Purity doesn't come from the church. Yielding our lives to Christ and following the way of Christ, it brings us to Christ and brings us to purity. Galatians 2 verse 16 says, "Know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ." That's it, by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Jesus Christ, and that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law, because the works of the law, no one will ever be justified. See, the Old Testament was all about the works of the law, and the New Testament was being justified by faith in Christ Jesus. And if we go back to Romans, which I preached on recently, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God. He's not our enemy anymore. We have peace through our Lord Jesus Christ. Justification, and it's this really big word again, I'm going to say what it is, just as if I'd never sinned. So we are seen as right with God and are able to be in his presence. That's what justification is. And then sanctified, it's the daily ongoing task of being made holy. So we sin and are forgiven, and we sin and are forgiven, then again we sin and are forgiven. And constantly it goes on until the day we're called to glory. But God is okay with this because we have been justified. So let's take heart from the disciples. Learning about God and recognizing God was one of the things that they were tasked with doing while here on earth. And then they had to help others who were following behind them as their disciples and becoming disciples of Christ Jesus to also see where God was at work. See how God wants things to be and how we may be part of it. It's easy to see how God wants things to be and then say, oh, but we won't be part of that. No, see how you might be part of it. Because if God's showing you how things should be, he's probably stirring you and prompting you a little bit to say, hey, you could be part of this too. And we need to find the difference between being made religiously right and being made spiritually right with God. This is such an important thing. One that was done by Jesus on a cross. And it wasn't religion. What Jesus did on a cross wasn't about religion. What he did on a cross was about justification and sanctification for each one of us. You know, brothers and sisters, I just want to encourage you about becoming a disciple. It's so easy to get caught up in the traditions of the church and to get caught up in the palaver of how we run church each week and then justifying why we're doing things because we almost use the religion as our excuse for why we're not doing certain things for God. Jesus took that on in this passage today. And I just want to encourage you that if you're shackled to the pragmatic faith that is sometimes a religious one, dare to open your eyes and your hearts to God today and just say, God, can you come in and wash me new? What was it? Keith Green's song, Rushing Wind Blow Through This Temple, Blowing Out the Dust Within. You know, and I think that that's what we sometimes need to do. We need to constantly look at those days when we can renew our lives in Christ. And may it be today. May you pray with me. Gracious God, may the input that comes into our life be that of the scriptures, be that a good fellowship, be that a good words and encouraging words from brothers and sisters, that it might also go to our innermost places, and may it also flow from there with love, compassion, mercy and grace, witnessing to the society that's around us. Gracious God, may we be ever so careful about how we see our traditions in the church. May we uphold them in a beautiful way, but not in a way that shackles us or makes us irrelevant. And we ask this in Christ's precious name. Amen. Let's sing our last song.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe in this broken generation. When all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, Christ, we believe in the Holy. Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again.
Folks, thanks for sharing in worship with us today. What a privilege it's been. Look, I just want to put a big shout out to all of the kids who are doing the HSC, because a lot of them are going through some real tough times and some real challenging times with where their schools are, especially in Victoria, and where some of our schools in New South Wales get shut down for a period of time. So if you know a Year 12 student or a Year 11 student who's heading into these exam times over the next couple of weeks, can you uphold them in your prayers? But not only them. Uphold the teachers who are teaching them as well, and the schools, because this is a really stressful time and there's some real challenges out there. Look, I just want to say to the chaplains who are doing your job through all of our schools, thank you. What a great privilege it is to know that you guys are ministering in such a warm and wonderful place at this time, bringing the hope of Christ into these school kids' lives. I mentioned earlier, it was my birthday, and look, thanks for all the well wishes, thanks for all the messages. I really do appreciate it. And just, you know, there's some funny things that happen as we go through the birthday. This was not how we planned to do the birthday this year. We were actually hoping to have a party of about 100 people, but that's for another day, and we're okay with it. What we do want you to do, though, and I'd just really like to think about this. A birthday is a time when we remember the day we were born. Well, I wonder if we remember the day when we came to know Christ. Because for each one of us, as we come to know Christ, there's a new start to our lives that takes place at that time. And it's a slight change in direction, or sometimes it's a huge change in direction. But it's taking a point from us being selfish and wanting to be arrogant controllers of our lives and yielding our lives to God. And I just want to encourage you, if you're at a point at this moment where you've tried everything else and you're not sure whether you're going to give God a go, give Him a try. I'm sure that His arms are wide open, saying, come over here. Let's just deal with this today. Let's do business together. Let's share love together. Let's get this happening. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, how good it is we can have just shared in this service. We thank You for the word that was preached, and also for the encouragement of the scriptures for us today. We thank You for the prayers that have lifted our hearts to You and our minds set on You as well. And we thank You for all these different worship styles and forms that we're able to listen to, and how they just feed into our spirit at this time. Gracious God, in these stressful times, in these challenging times, may Your spirit of peace come into our lives and give us courage and strength to face the days ahead. Amen. We're finishing with a choir today singing Oh Happy Day. I hope you really enjoy it. It's one of my favourite choir groups. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son and Holy Spirit rest upon you now and forever. Amen.
Oh happy day,
oh happy day,
oh happy day,
oh happy day,
when Jesus was,
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 He washed my sins away. Day.
Oh happy day.
Oh happy day.
Oh happy day.
Oh Jesus
was.
When Jesus
was.
When Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
When my Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
He washed my sins away.
Oh happy day.
Yeah.
Oh, happy day.
He
happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Yeah, when Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
When my Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
He washed my sins away.
Oh!